Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the introduction. As he said, my name is Osler Ortiz. I am a first-year PhD student in the Department of Agronomy and Horticulture. And today I am going to try to summarize some of our preliminary findings of last year's research focused on ear formation issues in corn. How this project started is that in 2016, several reports from farmer fields came to the university saying that there were some extreme conditions for ear formation issues in our Nebraska fields. Initially, we thought that it was a problem isolated to the Nebraska region, but later on, well-sustained reports were also received from other regions in the U.S. Those are listed here, included Texas Panhandle, moving north through eastern Colorado, also Iowa, and Illinois. So it was no longer a local concern, but more of a regional concern. Our framework is that ear formation issues in corn is likely the result of interactions between different factors. Those factors are genetics, environment, and management practices. Although specific causes are still to be found, and that's what we are hoping to do and trying to do. So our research objective is to study ear formation, causal agents of ear formation issues in corn and how that affects productivity. Why is that important? We think that by understanding and mitigating some of those issues, we will be able to reduce productivity losses in corn, and at the same time, we will be more efficient in the use of inputs and resources to our systems. How do we do in order to study this? So in 2018, we established 7 experimental fields located in eastern Nebraska. Those fields are highlighted here. 3 of them were UNL research farms. 4 of them were industry trials. That's collaboration and partnership that we have with some private companies in the area. In those 7 locations, we are evaluating different components. We are looking at different hybrids. We are looking at different delay planting. We are looking at different seeding rates from the low seeding rates all the way to very high seeding rates. And also, we are looking at different planting dates. This is an illustration of summarizing some of the plant measurements that we are taking in our samples of those 7 fields. First of all, we look at plant characteristics like ear height, ear node, internode length of those plants in a way to possible diagnose some of those. We look at the ear classification, which is our main target. Listed here, we have normal ears, we have short husks, we have barbell ears, and we have bouquet or multi-ears. Those are the main types of issues that were reported in 2016 when the project started. These are a few examples, pictures taken in our fields in 2018. Those are the main type of issues that we are trying to understand and trying to find out which are those causal agents. Looking into some of our preliminary results, here we are presenting the number of recorded issues among those fields. The tall bar is representing how many plants were assessed. So like saying at the UNL farms, we look at close to 20,000 plants. At the industry trials, we look to close to 35,000 plants. From all that number of plants that we evaluated, the numbers highlighted in the small bars are the number of issues that we were able to identify. So summarizing these, in general, 7% of ear issues were documented among those research fields in 2018. From that 7% of ear issues that were reported, this is the distribution among the different types. So in general, the short husk presented over 50% of those ear formation issues in corn. So that was the main driver of those numbers. And also, we were able to identify that when we move from low seeding rates to high seeding rates where there is more competition between plants, there is an increase in those ear formation issues as well. Some of our conclusions, ear issues at a 7% pressure were recorded in 2018. More issues were found at high seeding rates and at the susceptible hybrids. Our data is still being processed, and we plan to repeat these experiments in 2019 and 2020. Greenhouse and grow chamber experiments are to be added this year in order to understand better the environmental or climatology conditions. We think that reducing productivity losses is an imperative step towards sustainable agriculture, and also in that way we will be more efficient in the use of inputs and resources that we have into our systems. Some of project publications that we have to date, this is mostly extension work. A few seminars that have been presented on this topic, there is a lot of interest from our farmers in the area, and a few posters presentations as well. The one coming next is at the Water for Food Global Conference happening here in the next few weeks. And with that, thank you, and if there is time, I can take any question.
There's always time for a question. here we go. Go ahead, Justin.
I was just curious, do you see different issues dependent on the population? So as population increases, do you see more short husks or less short husks? Or like, how does the proportions change based on population?
Yes, thank you. Very good question. So how is the proportion of ear types changing as we move up in populations? So that's something definitely that we are interested. That's one of the specific questions that we have. Unfortunately, we didn't get to that point yet, but we will get there. Thank you.
I have a follow-up question. You showed the industry percentages around 5-something%, right? Has this been the typical percentage of these problems over the last 30 years, or have they increased with the new hybrid, high-producing varieties?
It's kind of challenging, the answer of that question. So usually, there is no, this type of protocol is not being applied in our cornfields. So there is not a specific value for those conditions, but now that we are starting, we are finding numbers relatively low, 5-7%. But again, when the project started in 2016, we went out to fields, Nebraska farmer fields, and some of the fields were up to a 50% damage. 50% damage is probably 50% reduction in yields. And those were farmers that were shooting for high yield conditions, irrigation, high fertility, medium to high population. So a lot of inputs being added and drastic reductions as a result of those interactions.
Interesting. Oh, one more question.
Did you look at correlation to fertility rates?
So if we look to correlation to fertility rates, that is not a component that we are studying right now, but we are trying our experimental fields, 7 experimental fields. We are working with high fertility programs in those fields so that we are enhancing high yielding potentials. And that's when 2016 year was seeing a lot of the issues under high inputs, a lot of several of those issues being recorded. So it's not a factor in our research right now, but indeed we have a high fertility program higher than the regular for our fields.
Okay, thank you, Oscar.
Thank you.